Good morning, everybody. Happy Resurrection Sunday. So glad to see you all here this morning. Make sure you grab your coffee, your hugs, your snacks, and your seats, and we're going to get started in just a minute.
Hey, we're going to get started. I think I'll just get some quick announcements out of the way real quick. First of all, remember, we'll do it in order. So this afternoon at 5 o'clock up at the Farringtons and the Willbroads, just going to have a barbecue. We're gonna make fire on our terms, right, in a fire pit, and make meat. Matter of fact, Clayton's got a brisket on the smoker right now, and there'll be burgers. And if you want to bring your own meat, because neither one of those appeal to you, that's fine. Bring a side dish. You know how it goes. We're just gonna just enjoy a beautiful evening by the fire and fellowship. So and then next Sunday is our annual business meeting. We need everybody here. You know, a pastor told me one time, if nobody shows up to the business meeting, that's a good sign. So he doesn't worry about it, you know. I don't worry about it either. I just look at it differently. I like to share vision and opportunity and report on what the Lord's done. We do have an amendment. You should have received copies of that. I emailed a copy of it out. If you have not gotten a copy of it, please let me know so I can make sure you have one. We'll be voting on an amendment to our Constitution. And so I'd like everybody here. So next Sunday after church, again, we'll just do a quick potluck, enjoy a meal together, do some business, and enjoy what the Lord's doing. Amen? So I think that's it. Yesterday had a great event at the track. I counted 175 people twice, so it was just a great time for the kids to look for eggs, and I got to stand and share the Lord with a couple of people, and so it was good. It's a good day. So let's worship the Lord. Yeah.
That God would provide for these kids to go to camp so that they could experience Jesus, learn about Jesus, and have fun. And it was going to cost a lot of money to send those kids to camp. And so we were going to scratch and X-nay the idea of, like, taking them to camp. And we were like, no, wait, let's pray. We sat there and we just prayed. And we said, Lord, we're asking you to provide supernaturally for these kids to go to church. Well, somebody, or sorry, to go to camp. And that day, somebody came in with a check. $5,000 check.
Yeah.
Because they said, we want these kids to go to camp.
Yeah.
That was the provision right there.
Yeah. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. That's good. That's good. And Young Life puts on just a incredible experience for kids. I mean, it's like going to dreamland for a week. There's an incredible facility over in Eastern Oregon, and so it's great. Well, what a beautiful day in the neighborhood, huh? And we get to worship the Lord today. Stand if you're able. Don't if you don't. And like Annie always says, you can dance, sing, kneel. This is just worship. So however you express yourself to the Lord, give it to Him. Amen.
Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for allowing us and encouraging us to take the time to acknowledge that this morning. Thank you for showing us again and again just how powerful you are. As we worship your name this morning, God, we just pray that you'd be able to fill this place with your Spirit. Let streams of living water flow. At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name, people cry out, Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, Lord, at your name, the Shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. We will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing, we will sing. There is no one like our God. We will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing.
And I'm never
So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never the Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secure. Yeah. We believe that this earth will soon dissolve like snow, making way for spring, the springtime of your kingdom. We thank you for the price you paid so that we could come and sit at your feet and enjoy the light of your love. You suffered and died so that we could be together. And there is no greater joy than that, no greater hope than that. God, we thank you for your amazing grace. And as we worship your name this morning, we rest in the peace of the knowledge that your kingdom will be forever. And we will be forever yours, and you will be forever ours. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord.
Thank you guys all for coming. Happy Easter, happy Resurrection Day. It's a beautiful day outside. We're super blessed that we get such amazing weather for today, especially in Oregon, that loves to bless us with surprises all the time. As I was preparing for today, God just kind of took me and was like, okay, what is Easter all about? What is it all about? Because depending where we look, you get different answers. We have a lot of answers told to us from all surrounding, if you talk to a lot of kids, it's about the chocolate bunny and their Easter basket and Easter egg hunts. Or if you talk to them, they might talk about Jesus dying for them. And, there's a lot of different parts to our Easter tradition, celebration. But what is it really all about? Because, there's so many things we could input there of, it's about the resurrection of Jesus. And then people are like, okay, what is the resurrection of Jesus? What is that? I've heard that word, but what does that mean? What does it mean to me? What is it supposed to mean to me? And so that's where I really want to just kind of go into this and kind of unpack what is Easter. And part of Easter in the tradition this last week is called Holy Week. Or Passion Week is, and that's from the Jewish heritage of celebrating Messiah and Passover and the different points along the way. And so I want to kind of back up to, with it, okay, do we get excited about Easter? Is Easter something to get excited about? Is it like Christmas? Because, I asked somebody, I'm like, and they're like, it's like Christmas. It's one of those Christian holidays. Yeah, it is. You're right. Christmas is about the birth of Jesus, and Easter is about the resurrection of Jesus. But I know for a lot of people see the significance of Christmas. But I know a lot of people that don't see any significance for Easter. And for me, it's like, that's so sad. We're missing on a whole part of this, because this is part of the whole message and the story of what is Christmas and what is Easter, and what does that mean to me as a Christian living in 2024? As many of you know and probably have heard, our government structure right now is trying to rename today, Easter Sunday, as Transgender Day. So that is what has kind of been put out, and they want no significance of Christianity with it, which is nothing new. We live in a fallen world, which I would say, if you really back up and look through the history of Easter, it's nothing new. That's why we have a bunny rabbit at Easter. Like, when you look through the history of it, the whole rabbit and the eggs, that's all pagan holiday form of the rabbit signified the blessing of vitality, and then you have the eggs that it leaves, but that kind of got incorporated in through the Roman times into Christianity. And you know, it's not that I'd say, oh, it's bad to do an Easter egg hunt. Oh, it's bad to have a rabbit. No, those aren't bad things. But when we lose the significance of what Easter is really about, then yeah, you know what? It's taking the place. And that's where for our government, they say, oh, you know, the Easter colors, the spring bright colors. Oh, see, that's all about the flag and the transgender movement. And we're going to rename this as this. This is that holiday. It's like, no, that's not what it's about. Spring is about the rebirth. All the bulbs are coming up, and it's bringing bright color and bringing back life, just like when Jesus came back to life and brought back that life. So that's where I'm going to dig into this. You're going to get lots of fun information, and so I'm just going to say, you know what, I'm just going to ask you to follow along, because I just want to give a big, brief synopsis of Passion Week and why. So our basic is the breaking it down. Easter is the remembrance of Christ's voluntary death and resurrection to save humankind from sin and death. And I think that's the part that sometimes we forget, that significance of he did this voluntarily because he loved us, because he wanted us to have a way out. Because without his sacrifice, that means we would have to pay that price before God for our sin. And our consequence of sin is death. So therefore, Jesus voluntarily stood in that place and said, you know what? I'll take it on me. So when we look into Passion Week, it'll start with Palm Sunday. I believe we have a slide for that. So Passion Week is considered the Judaic term, and the more Western term is Holy Week. It starts with Palm Sunday of Jesus entered Jerusalem. Is there scriptures at the bottom of that? Oh, okay, awesome. I was like, okay, no, you're good. I just didn't know if it would, I wasn't sure how that would all pop up. You're good. I just like, wait, oh no. But the meaning of Palm Sunday is last Sunday was Palm Sunday. This is when Jesus came in. They took the palm leaves and they put them down. They got the donkey, put Jesus on the donkey, and had him come into Jerusalem. And they hailed him as king, saying, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And you know, this is when Jesus, you know, it's the importance of it is the fulfillment of prophecy and the beginning of the end of Jesus' earthly ministry. That was that moment in time when when Jerusalem came and said, you are the king. But it's the end of his ministry, because this is what Jesus was there for. And we can read through, you know, in Matthew 21, 1 through 11, Mark 11, 1 through 11, Luke 19, 28 to 44, and John 12, 12 to 19. So those are all tell of that time when Jesus came in. Well, did you know there's this interesting little fact? Jesus even marked creation and nature. with riding in on a donkey? Do you know that there's a difference? If you look at animals, there are something called Jerusalem donkeys, and then there's donkeys. A Jerusalem donkey is set apart because on that donkey, here you have the standard donkey, but on his back, there is a stripe that runs right down the middle of its shoulder blades and from arm to arm. It has a cross on its back, and that's what signifies a Jerusalem donkey. Those Jerusalem donkeys are marked for creation, that's what Jesus came riding in on. And, you know, those are parts of, like, that's a Jerusalem donkey. And you know, there's different breedings and things, but you can still look at those donkeys today, and they still have that marking on them. And you'll see people with pet donkeys like, oh, there's a Jerusalem donkey. That was a donkey mark signifying that this animal was created with the sole purpose to usher Jesus in, our sacrifice, the sacrifice he did for us, that even nature reflects it. And it's around us, and it's just, okay, do we pay attention to those things of, like, oh, you know, that's just that little God mark of, oh, here you go, here's your reminder that this little donkey ushered Jesus in. And, you know, when you think about it, of we celebrate Palm Sunday and then Easter Sunday. In a week's time, Jesus went from being hailed as king in Jerusalem to being crucified on a cross, where even a lot of his own disciples didn't stand around and stand witness of, you know, as it goes, we'll talk about it a little bit of when, you know, Peter denies him. All these things happen in that time of, you know, think about the process going from a hailed king to a sacrifice. You know, and it's just like, wow, there's so much in that. And, you know, and I like us just to think about, okay, so that's why we have Palm Sunday. Those palm branches, which palm branches represent a stretching out of grace to people. A lot of tribal cultures stretch out palm branches when new people come in. And that is a form of extending the palm leaf, the palm branch, to say, you're welcome, I'm going to welcome you, you're welcome here. And that's where I'd say that's kind of what was happening, of people were welcoming Jesus as their king, taking him on as their savior. So that's the start of Passion Week. And then we go into Holy Monday. And the meaning behind Holy Monday is when Jesus comes and he cleanses the temple. So we've heard of, okay, he cleansed the temple. What did that look like? This is when Jesus comes in and he is so grieved of seeing the temple courts in Jerusalem, that people, that these money changers have set up tables and they're selling offerings, is what it all came down to. Is when you look at it, they had these tables of, typically in the Jewish culture, you had to bring your sacrifice to the temple and they would slaughter it. So the best, most expensive offering you could bring would be an unspotted, unblemished lamb. That was like the offering to bring. But if you couldn't afford that, then maybe you brought a white, spotless dove. Or, you know, and so here's these people that, instead of people having to go and prepare that and take the time of sacrifice, of saying, you know what, I've done wrong, this, and part of that sacrifice was saying, okay, this is going to go in my place for what I've done. I'm giving this offering as a sacrifice to cover what I've done wrong. And that was the whole point of the offering in the temple, that once a year you'd go, you'd prepare your offering, you'd bring it. And so typically, a family might prepare the offering that they might have a flock of sheep, that they could get a spotted, unblemished lamb to come offer. But then all of a sudden, here Jesus comes into the temple, and here's people just selling all this stuff, where his house that's supposed to be a house of prayer has been turned into a den of thieves, is what the Bible tells us. That here these people, money changers, people have set up that, oh, you know what? here, come change your money and we'll give you an, oh, we're going to take a cut too. Oh, here's your sacrifice and we're going to take a cut too. And Jesus knocks these tables over because here's this, the house of the Lord had been turned into a den of thieves. The importance is emphasizing the purity and sanctity of God's house, that Jesus was the sacrifice, that these animals couldn't atone for the people's sin, that only Jesus' precious blood could. And that's part of that of, you know, Jesus had to come in and show, like, wait, this is not going to cut it. This is not going to cut for what you need. Only I can be the pure sacrifice. Only I can be that. And that's what Jesus wanted to be for us. Because instead of us having to go and offer continually a sacrifice, Jesus came once and for all that we wouldn't have to do to slaughter that animal every year. That Jesus' blood covers all of our sins. You know, that's a big deal. And so that's where Holy Monday represents when Jesus came in on Palm Sunday. He goes to the temple, cleanses the temple because he is the sacrifice. And then we go into Holy Tuesday. And so Tuesday comes and Jesus then starts teaching and going into his parables. So when we read through Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we'll go through and Jesus starts talking about those parables and the main importance of Jesus is preparing his disciples for what's to come. That he's giving them these parables. He's giving them these messages to carry the gospel. That this is truly the start of the sending out, of Jesus saying, okay, the time has come. I'm here to pay the sacrifice. I have to get you guys ready because you're going to be going out. You guys are going to be carrying this message that I am fulfilling the prophecy right now, that I'm in the temple. I'm becoming the sacrificial lamb, and I am preparing the way of the Lord. And so then Passion Week, as it transitions, we get to Spy Wednesday. And I've always kind of thought, what? Why Spy Wednesday? Well, Spy Wednesday is when Jesus, or Judas, does the agreement to betray Jesus. And this is where Judas was one of the disciples. And he betrays Jesus for pieces of silver. And so if you go to Israel, there's a place called Potter's Field that, as we know, Judas afterwards went and hung himself after Jesus was crucified. And they took those pieces of silver and they bought Potter's Field. And that is a place where in Israel, in current days, if people can't afford to be buried somewhere, they bury them in Potter's Field. So it is considered... for those that are disenfranchised, that don't have enough, that they can have it because Judas gave up that. But this is the Spy Wednesday, is that Judas agrees to become the spy. The importance of the turning point towards Jesus' arrest, because Jesus had to be arrested and convicted. So this is truly what changed on Wednesday. It changed from him being king, him being welcome to teach in the temple, to this turning point where he's going to be arrested by the Pharisees. And so, you know, this is our whole progression of Passion Week. And then we get into Maundy Thursday, which I believe it's Maundy. You can correct me. I don't know if I'm saying it right. I've always heard it Maundy. But the meaning behind that is the Last Supper, where Jesus comes and washes the disciples' feet and the institution of the Lord's Supper. So that's a lot of Christianese. The Last Supper, Jesus comes with the 12 and meets and they eat around the table and they're sitting there, and typically in Jewish time, the lowest of the low servant would come and wash who all the guests' feet. Because, you know, you have to think about, this is a arid climate, and they had sandals, you know. We have our nice boots and hiking boots and this for going into terrain, but they had sandals. And think of the sand and dust that would get in there, and, you know, hot, arid, your feet are probably sweating, it's sticky, it's dirty, you know, how much mud's caked in there. And, you know, this is also in a time when baths were not considered a common occurrence. So, you know, here for a servant to have to go wash everyone's feet, it was considered the lowly job. The lowest of the low servant had to do that. And here all the disciples came together. So Jesus has all his disciples and himself. And he then takes on, and he takes out his outer garments. He puts a towel around him, and he goes and starts taking the disciples' feet and washing their feet, cleansing them. And that's a point of, you know, Jesus came to serve. Even though he was the king, he was the servant. That, you know, how many of those other disciples, in culture, in our life, we'd say, oh, that person should have to do it. Oh, John should have been the one doing that. Or, oh, Judas should have been the one. You know, that's what we'd like to look at and be like, no, that wasn't Jesus' job. He didn't need to do that. But that's the exact point in that. It wasn't Jesus' job. He did not need to do that. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. But he humbled himself. He came before and said, you know what? I'm going to put myself in the lowest point. I'm going to put myself so I can wash the feet of my disciples. That I can prepare them to have this meal together. And then it goes into the Lord's Supper, which is communion, breaking the bread and the wine and the juice, that the blood and body of Jesus is broken for our sins. And that's where the importance is, that it establishes the sacrament of communion, which is the sacrament is, it's one of those holy, in the church, we call it a sacrament, because that's a holy thing that we get to take and take part in. That we take the bread that represents Jesus' broken body, that his body was broken for us. Because I'll get into that, of what he actually went through. And then we take the juice as the represent of his blood. And then we get into Good Friday. This is when it starts happening. Things are changing. There's tension within this community. Judas has betrayed Jesus. Jesus has been arrested. They had the Last Supper. And here is the crucifixion and death of Jesus, which for most would say this is the low point for the disciples at this point. Except they knew Jesus, because he said, I have come to fulfill the law. That he had prepared those disciples with that teaching of saying, no, this is not the end. Me dying, it's not the end. That's what he was preparing them for, that this was not the end. And that's why it's Good Friday. This is the good thing, that Jesus is hung on that cross, that he's gone through the whipping, the beating, that he's gone through shedding his blood. For us, the importance is the atonement for sins through Jesus' sacrifice. That there is something that takes the place of our wrongdoing, of our sin. That's why when it comes that when we confess our sins to Jesus, Jesus takes them on as if he did them. And that's why the Bible says they're remembered no more. When we ask Jesus forgiveness of our sin, Jesus physically, and this is where the cross is that point for all of time, that when we are in right relationship with Jesus and when we ask for it and we repent and ask Jesus to cover our sins, he literally took those on himself and took them on the cross. for all of humanity, all of time, that we no longer had to pay for sin and death, because the consequence of sin was death. Something had to die, that blood had to be shed to spill to cover that sin. And Jesus did it and gave us our way out. And so thus, Good Friday is a good day, because it means I have a way out. I have something that has, I have a way that can atone for sin and death, that I'm not the one that's going to have to stand and be crucified. Jesus made the way. So then we go to Black Saturday. So Jesus has been crucified. He went through all the persecution, had to carry his cross through the streets, which we'll get into. And the soldier came and pierced Jesus' side, and blood and water flowed, which we'll get into that significance of why. And now his body has been taken and put in the tomb. And Jesus' body is officially in the tomb, and thus it's Black Saturday, because his body has been laid to rest. And this is the importance of Black Saturday, is it's a day of reflection and waiting. Because as we know, Jesus doesn't stay dead. We're waiting. It's a Black Saturday. It's that waiting for the resurrection to come. Because Jesus is going to go and deal with sin and death, with Satan. And so, you know, it's that day of waiting and reflection. And then we get to Easter Sunday, which is the resurrection of Jesus. That is what we celebrate on Easter Sunday. Easter is another way of saying the resurrection day of Jesus. This is when Jesus, early in the morning, they came to the tomb. So the history of this tomb, it was in a garden, and the soldiers had put this huge stone in front of the tomb that took several people to move. It wasn't just something a couple people could get together and move. This is a thick stone that was like for a catacomb that would hold these bodies in. And so when Jesus' body was put in there, he was prepped in burial cloth, and he was put in, and they rolled the stone in front of the tomb. And then they set guards in front of it, so nobody, because people had talked about, those Christians, those followers are going to come steal his body. And so they put guards there to make sure that wasn't going to happen. But you know what? In the middle of the morning, the guards were overcome and the stone was rolled away. You know, how would you like to be that guard? You know, put yourself in the middle of this story for a second. This is your job, that you're guarding this tomb, that the people cannot come steal this body. All of a sudden, you're standing guard. This stone is moving behind you. You go and like, oh no, what's happening? You go in the tomb and it's empty. You're going to be like, what is going on? And this is after, I should have pointed that part out. When Jesus died on the cross, Jesus up there, he says, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. It is finished. And the sky grew dark. There was actual darkness that came over the earth for that time. That's another reason why it's Black Saturday. And then they went and laid him to rest. Like, all the people in Jerusalem have been seeing what's going on. Whether they believe that he was the Son of God or not, things are happening, getting people's attention. And then the stone is rolled away and Jesus is not there. The importance of that is it's victory over sin and death. Death could not hold Jesus because he was the Son of God. He was the King of Kings. He is the King of Kings. He is the Son of God. It's not just a was. It is a was, is, and is to come. The foundation of the Christian faith has been established, that Jesus paid and made a way, that we have a way over sin and death. So in 1 Peter 1:3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That is the foundation of the Christian faith. So when that Easter Sunday has happened, that is what's forming it. And then in 1 Peter, it's talking about this is that we, the blessed God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy, God had mercy on us that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. These are these verses, and this is where they actually come to life, that we are given eternal life through Jesus to a living hope. It's not a dreaded hope. It's not to a mere existence. But in 1 Peter, it tells us he has caused us to be born again into a living hope. Living hope means that we have hope. We have a reason to live. We have been empowered by the sacrifice of Jesus, that we've been given something that we can share with others, that even on our worst day, we have a living hope, because we know our worst day on earth is nothing compared to our eternity in heaven. Because Jesus resurrected from the dead, it gave us our living hope. He is who he says he is. And that is Passion Week. That is what creates Easter, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. That is why we celebrate Easter, Resurrection Day. That is our hope, our living hope. It becomes part of who we are. It becomes part of our story of how is it you can go through these hard things? How is it you can do this? Because I have a living hope. Because Jesus Christ sacrificed himself to give me hope. To give me that I have an eternal salvation in heaven. That he paved a way that I might live because he died. Jesus voluntarily gave his life that we might live. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane right after Palm Sunday, he had taken all the disciples there praying in the garden. And this is when Jesus goes and pleads before God. God, let this cup pass from me. And Jesus' answer to God is, okay, God, not my will, but your will be done. That is where it was the sacrifice. Jesus took on and said, God, I'll give up my life. I will willingly, gladly give up my life that all your children can live and have eternity. So, some interesting facts. I want to talk about what Jesus actually did. Because we talked about Passion Week, we heard about it, but okay, Jesus died. He was beaten, he was flogged. He paid that sin. Great. Anybody can do that, right? Everyone got that. No, this is like a supernatural thing that Jesus did. Because when you actually So this is where some of the science and all that comes in. Jesus, at the age of 33, was condemned to death. At 33, life is over. Condemned to death. He had 3 years of ministry, and in 3 years, Jesus established the foundation of Christianity. At the time, crucifixion was the worst death that one could have done. Only the worst criminals were condemned to be crucified. Yet, it was even more dreadful for Jesus, because the worst criminals would be crucified, but they wouldn't have gone through the beating and the flogging, the whipping, the humiliation beforehand. They would have just been crucified. And that was considered the worst punishment at the time. So not only did Jesus take on the worst punishment, but then he took on the worst beating beforehand. Jesus was to be nailed on the cross by his hands and feet. Each nail was about 6 to 8 inches long. And it went through, because like a lot of people, Jewish scholars look at, if the nail would have been right here, up here in the middle of the hand, like we commonly think, it would have just tore out, because there's nothing. That it actually would go in right here in your wrist, hitting the main carotid artery, so that it would be, that blood would happen. But at this joint, because it is not physically possible for the human body to be held up through your skin, it would tear out from the weight of your body. So it actually went in just under the wrist joint, because there's a bone there, and it actually went through the two bones and held him on either side. So one in each hand. And then, because, you know, if we just let it, you hang there, that'd be too nice. So they actually push your legs up, that you're bent out, so that you'd have to force yourself up. And they put one leg in front of the other, and the same thing, just above the foot in the ankle bone, a nail would go through. So he is there on the cross, that these main arteries are there, that the blood is pouring out. But it's not just a gentle hanging there. This is causing excruciating. Every muscle in your body is contracting from the pain and from having to hold yourself up, because if you hang, it hurts even worse. Jesus went through this. And that was just the crucifixion part. Because did you know also, there's a tendon that comes from your shoulder all the way down to your wrist. That, like, when people get carpal tunnel, it actually affects their shoulder as well. And part of that, why that nail went in there, was to pierce that tendon so that you can't even pull your shoulders back. Because this is about the excruciation of, this was considered the worst form of torture, that is actually pulling every muscle and tendon within the body. Sorry, I'm trying to see where I was. So when that happens, those tendons pull on your chest, and it makes your whole chest tighten, that it becomes even difficult to breathe. This is what crucifixion was designed for, that it was designed to be the most painful, most excruciating thing that one could bear. And Jesus did that for us. Now, we like to think, oh, okay, that was a lot. Jesus did that for us. He went through all that for us. But did you know that's not all he did? And did you know that he endured on that cross for about 3 hours? That time that most could not make for even an hour, he hung there for three till he said it was finished. And in that time, like, there's some significant thing that happens in those 3 hours. That is when the one other criminal next to Jesus on the cross, all he did was looked at Jesus and said, "Surely you are the Son of God." That criminal knew through, because of what he was able to endure, "Surely you are the Son of God." And Jesus' answer is, "You'll be with me today in paradise." That's all it took, was for someone to believe who Jesus said he was. That's all we had to do. Now, part of us living for Christ is representing him, is coming in, having that communion with Christ, and having that right relationship. But when it comes down to belief of who Jesus is, it matters who you believe Jesus is. Because within a moment of that criminal believing who Jesus was, Jesus answered him. It matters who you believe Jesus is. A few minutes before Jesus died, he actually stopped bleeding. The human body holds about 3.5 liters of blood. And did you know there's this crazy thing that happens? When your body no longer has blood to bleed, do you know that what starts coming out? Water. When you have a wound on a main artery that it has pushed out all the blood, your bodies keep pushing, because even though you die, sometimes the heart will keep contracting and it'll keep pushing the blood out. And when typically someone bleeds to death, they'll be covered in water. Jesus was still alive when the soldier pierced his side and blood and water flowed, because there was no more blood within him to bleed, water came out. That every drop of Jesus' blood was shed on the cross. That there was no blood left in him. That all that was left was water to come out. Because he shed all that blood between the beating and whipping and the crucifixion. He held nothing back from us. He sacrificed it all, that there would be more than enough, that there would never be a question whether or not he did not give all. So, have you ever seen an Easter play or a recreation of it? And you see Jesus and they bring him and they tie him and they're whipping him with this whip. This isn't like an Indiana Jones whip that just, or like the horse whip that has a couple pieces of leather on the end. Jesus was given lashes with a cat of nine tails, which is basically this whip that comes and it has nine tails. And in it are these shards of metal that basically look like fish hooks. And it has broken glass tied within it. So that basically when these nine tails come around you, I'm sorry, I'm going to use you. These tails come around, they basically grip your body. And then when they yank it, it actually tears and brings the skin and muscle. Like, that's what Jesus went through in his beating. And they did it over and over and over again. Not only did they give him the 40 lashes, they took this crown of thorns, which a lot of people say, oh, it's just this crown that, you know, is set up on his head because he was the king. This was them trying to mock him as the king. So a crown of thorns is this wicked, wicked, like, you think of our worst blackberries here. On the crown of thorns, the thorns actually extend 3 to 4 inches out. It's this wicked bush, that vine that grows, and it dries and it hardens. So they lashed that into a crown. They took it and they pounded it on his head. So these thorns actually pierced into his skull. Like, this is the torment Jesus went through for us. He was stripped down to basically a loincloth, which is basically a piece of cloth that goes around his private areas. And then he was forced to carry his own cross. Which I had to do some math, because according to Jewish scholars, it's 30 kilos is what just the structure piece for most crucifixions was. And they don't know exactly how big Jesus' cross was, but most of the crosses from the time, that was about 30 kilos, which is just over 66 pounds. Just for the cross member, because they had put that on. And then they added the upright. And Jesus went, and they call it the Via della Rosa, through the streets of Jerusalem, where he had to carry this cross that his hands were attached to. He had to carry it through the streets. And that's about 2 kilometers that he went through, which is just over 1.2 miles, is the whole Via della Rosa, of the where Jesus went from basically the prison holding place at the temple to Golgotha, the place of the skull where he was crucified. And he had to go through there, and there came a point where he stumbled and someone had to try to help him. But this whole time, you know, you think the week before, people were throwing down palm branches. Oh, Hosanna, Hosanna. That's not what people are doing this time. People were spitting, throwing rocks, because he had been condemned to death because the Sanhedrin had said, oh, no, you can't say you're the Son of God. Nope, you can't do that. The Pharisees plotted against him, turned people, that now he's having rocks hurled at him, spat upon, and all this time he willingly endured it for us. He went through the most excruciating death to the point that he bled every ounce of blood within him. Because even water flowed from his body. And science proves that that means it's all been there. It's all out. Jesus shed that for us. Gave us a way to defeat sin and death. And that is what the story of Easter is about. That's significant. That's huge. That's life-changing for us. This is not just any day. It's not just like every other day of the week. It's not even like every other day of Passion Week, where we celebrate every one of those things Jesus went through and the fulfillment and the meaning that was happening of the fulfillment of prophecy. This is about Easter, when Jesus has come back to life. He raised from the dead, appeared back to the disciples, and said, okay, now you go make disciples. Now you go. Now it's your turn. Because I paid the price. I paid the price on the cross that God can look on us and not see our sin. That now when God looks at us, he looks through this film of Jesus' blood, the blood of Christ. When he looks at us, when he looks at his sons and daughters, he no longer looks and sees the disobedience, the sin, he looks and sees the blood of Jesus shed over your life. That is what happens when you ask Jesus into your heart. That is what happens when you say, surely you are the Son of God. Is now Jesus' blood is put out over you, that when you stand before the Heavenly Father, all he can do is smile down upon you because he looks at you through Jesus' blood that was shed. That is the story of Easter. That is the story of Resurrection Sunday. It changes all of humanity. It changes even our Christian faith, that we no longer had to come up with a sacrifice. A sacrifice was made, was buried, died and was buried, and then rose again. That is where it changed the whole Christian structure to put our Christianity into practice of this is who he says he is. Jesus is surely the Son of God that was killed, buried, paid the price of sin and death, and overcame it. A lot of people might have paid the price of sin beforehand, but you know, no one but Jesus has overcome it and come back from death and did it sacrificially that someone else could be in the place. Because that's the part of that spotless lamb was without sin. Jesus was without sin. He did nothing to deserve the punishment that he received. He did it for us, for all of humankind. He made a road, a way that we have something to follow. That's a big sacrifice. It's also a big gift. It's a free gift that we've been given and offered and said, this is yours if you choose to believe in it. This is yours if you choose to follow in it. Do you want it? Is that what you want? Or do you just want to do it on your own? Because, you know, I know a lot of people that I got it. I'll do it myself. I don't need that stuff. That whole Christian, I don't need it. And you know what? That breaks my heart. That's about the worst thing someone could ever say, that they don't need Christ. Because Christ went through this as a free gift. Christ did this that we might live, that we would have a way out, that we don't have to go through those things. And we have people that say, oh, I want to go through that, is basically what we're saying. I want to pay my own price. I don't want that. And that's like, no, you don't understand what that is. Do you realize what Jesus did? Do you realize that free gift that's given, that all we have to do is say, surely you are the Son of God. Jesus, you are who you say you are. I believe in you. Jesus, I want to be in relationship with you. I give up my rights and say, Jesus, I take on you. And now I'm going to follow you. And I'm going to do the things you said I can do. Because that's the really cool part. Is Jesus didn't just give us eternal salvation. He also said, you know what? You're going to do what I did and greater. So he gave us all those things. We're a free gift. As part of being in right relationship with him and following him, he gave us healing. He gave us power to overcome the enemy. He gave us hope and living hope at that. It's not just that we have a hope in something. We have a living hope. That the difference between hope and living hope, hope can change. I can have hope one day, and the next day, it can be gone. But Jesus gives us living hope. Living hope is this distinction by itself because it's something that has life in it. It's something that cannot be gone the next day. It is a living hope. There is no end to it till he returns. That is what our free gift is. We have living hope through him. And that's why we celebrate Easter. That's why we celebrate Palm Sunday. That's why we celebrate Passion Week, of all these stages of Jesus' journey from being hailed as king to the being hung on the cross to being risen again. That's why we celebrate. That's why we hold significance to that. That's why we don't let go of that. Because a lot of people can tell you, I can even tell you, but that's why we need to know what does the Bible say that Jesus did for us? Why does it matter what he did? Because it changes who I am. It changes me from just being stuck, hopeless. It changes me into having living hope, into having relationship with him, to being overcome by his presence, that he gives us what we need when we need it, when we're willing to do what he says. And that is our story of Easter. You want me to do the next part, or are you doing the next part? Okay. So we're going to do communion as part of our Easter Sunday, just like Jesus did with his disciples. We enter into communion as part of celebrating who Jesus is, that his body and blood were poured out and broken for us. So, thank you.
Thank you, Clayton, taking us on that journey. Annie, why don't you just begin to lead us in worship? And as you worship and respond to the Lord, there's a table right behind this section. There's a table over behind this section. Go ahead and serve yourselves and return to your seat. And when we're ready, we'll finish with doing what Jesus said, when we gather, do this in remembrance of me. And I'm going to tell you why he said, do this in remembrance of me. So just right behind you over on this side and right behind you on this side. And feel free to grab two for somebody if you want to serve someone else. And if you'll just hold those, each of you should have two cups. One cup has the bread and the other one has the drink. So Jesus said, 11, verse 24 says, and when he had given thanks, he broke the bread and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after he took the cup, saying, the cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. So he said that twice. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That ties back to the living hope. So this is not a memorial. This is a very different practice. He said two things, and he said it twice. Do it in remembrance of me. And he said, when you do it, you proclaim my death until I come. So a memorial is for a once was and a has been. This is a proclamation. And so these are just symbols. I don't believe that it was ever Jesus' intent, because he had a meal with them, his Last Supper, that this was ever supposed to become like a religious event that's just about symbols. This is an outward expression of an inward relationship and a proclamation of what is an ongoing work in our lives until he comes, and that is that our sin is atoned for. That's a celebration. Why did he say, do this in remembrance of me? Because you have to consider the audience. The audience was Jewish. And so for centuries, the remembrance was of the Passover where they were delivered from Egypt. Remember where the death angel was going to come over Egypt? But anyone who had blood, this was prophetic toward the cross, anyone who had blood, the blood of a lamb over their doorposts, that household would be preserved, would be saved, right? And then the Passover was also a celebration of the deliverance of Egypt through, of Israel through the ocean that parted. And so that was always the remembrance. And Jesus pauses and says, it's a new thing. Now, you're not going to be doing this in remembrance of those events. You're going to be doing this in remembrance of me. Lord, we have not forgotten, and we don't do this as a memorial of a dead person. We do this as a proclamation of one who is alive and well and continues to sustain our lives and our growth until eternity. And we look forward to another day when you return for us. Thanks, Lord. Thanks, Lord. Now, would you eat that bread in remembrance of him, proclaiming until he comes, and drink that cup? Thank you, Lord. We do this together for your glory, for our good, and for your glory. We celebrate your life. Not that you lived, but that you live. Amen? Amen. Let's worship him.
And there's not a place your mercy in
than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing. Lord, we thank you so much. I never enjoy learning more about how much you suffered for us, but it's an important part because this is the ultimate love story. It's one thing to just say that you love us, but God, you showed us, you demonstrated for us through Jesus, the lengths and the depths to which your love will go, your true and perfect love. Every day you're teaching us more about what love means. And Lord, I'm so thankful that I never have to stop learning about your love. Lord, show us this week, this month, this year, this lifetime, this eternity, how much you love us. Let us see every million, billion, gazillion ways that you love us, so that we can learn to love you back. Yes, we love you, Lord. We love you, we love you, we love you.
Thank you, Lord.
Do you have another song?
If we want to, but it is 11:30.
Yeah? What is it?
Lord, I lift you on.
Oh, let's do it.
Okay.
Yeah. We'll finish with this song, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. And I'm going to let you dismiss yourselves, and we'll just continue to play. And if you need prayer today, man, please don't leave without someone praying with you. We'll be available for that. I love this song because it's the whole Bible in a sentence. He left his place to come to our place, to take our place so that we can go back to our place, to his place, excuse me. That's the whole Bible right there. Amen.
I'm so glad you're in.